Sa panalo ng Golden State Warriors kanina, marami ang niniwala na nasa kanila ang momentum sa NBA Western Conference Finals. Habang sa Eastern Conference Finals naman, titiritin ng Cleveland Cavaliers na maitabla ang serye nila kontra sa upstart ng Boston Celtics bukas. Let's talk now to basketball analyst and blogger Enzo Flo for his thoughts on both these series. Enzo, welcome back.
Hey, Deej.
Long time no see. Saw you kanina.
Live
stream ng Rixona sa ating score. Okay, let's start with the Eastern Finals. If you're a Cleveland fan entering Game 3, on a scale of 1 to 10, how worried were you for Cleveland that this is they're in trouble? Because they're down 0-2, and if you go down 0-3, even if you say you have LeBron James, no team in NBA playoff history has come back from 0-3.
Yes, for sure. But interesting question, Teach, because I have a couple of very diehard LeBron fans. And entering Game 3, they were nervous.
They were nervous.
Siguro on a scale
even
of 1
though to 10. Nila yun,
ha? Yeah. And even though they have a pretty good record at home for this set of playoffs. Siguro maybe 7 out of 10 yung anxiety nila going into Game 3 because this Boston team, despite not having their two most arguably talented players in Kyrie Irving and Gordon Hayward, they are so well coached and they've been able to beat Cleveland in a way very convincingly the first two games. So heading back into Cleveland, medyo may kaba even if you're a very, very big Cleveland fan. But the thing you have to remember is, again, Cleveland has LeBron James. And at home so far in the playoffs, they've been very, very good. After losing that game against Indiana in the first round, they haven't lost any home game yet. And they've been, you know, pretty invincible at home. And it really seems like Cleveland's a very different team when they're playing at home. You saw that in the Indiana series. And of course, when they swept Toronto, Raptors, it didn't really matter. But you see that here. Now, there's a added string in their, spring in their step. They feed off the crowd really, really well. The complexity of the game was just different.
And on the flip side, the Celtics are not a good road player.
Yes, they're a very, very bad road team. Remember in the first round, they were pushed to the limit by Milwaukee. They lost all the road games in that first round. They lost, I think, one road game also in against Philadelphia.
And,
it's going to be very tough for them on the road. This is where they're really going to miss Kyrie and Gordon Hayward, two guys who
veteran
guys, and two guys who can kind of flip the switch. I know that's a cliche already, but on the road in the playoffs against someone like LeBron James, you need guys like that.
Okay, let's adjust a few things. For one, the inconsistency or consistency of the supporting cast of LeBron James.
and
start with start with George Hill. How big was he being aggressive and scoring in game number 3?
They needed him badly. I mean, I think he scored like 11 points in the first quarter yesterday in game 3 for Cleveland. And, you know, out of all the guys that they got in that big mid-season trade, it's really George Hill who can make an immediate impact at this stage
because of his
experience. He's won a championship already before. And, you know, he's the kind of guy, many people see him as a role player, and rightfully so. But in the right moments, he can be a difference maker, especially for a team like this that LeBron has already. And he proved that in Game 3. Sometimes when he's lackadaisical on offense, it's because he feeds off his defense. And pag nasuskuran siya ng Terry Rozier, ng Jaylen Brown, medyo nahihirapan siyang makabawi on the offensive end. So if he's solid defensively, he feeds off of that, and he's more confident offensively already.
For the Celtics, they still have a 2-1 lead. They've got a chance for a split and come out 3-1 ahead. What are they doing right? And what are the things that that they did in games 1 and 2 right that, you know, that lacked some things in game number 3?
What I love about Boston is their tenacity. Their capacity to just attack each and every position. It's like, you don't have, unlike when they have Kyrie Irving, it's clear who the point of attack is. But here, with Jaylen Brown, Terry Rozier, even Marcus Morris, parang you don't know where the offense is going to come from. You know Al Horford is their all-star. He's maybe their best player right now. Their most experienced, clearly. But even he, at times, defers to the young guys. And that's how balanced Boston is, how deep they are even. But again, on the road against Cleveland, it's going to be very, very difficult. And Game 4 is going to be very crucial. I think if they win Game 4, going home, Cleveland's on the ropes. Going back to Boston.
LeBron's been in a 1-3 series
before. He has. It's going to be very tough against Brad Stevens, though.
If
Boston loses Game 4, I think Cleveland gets this entire series. So that's going to be the big game
Now. Shifting over to the other side, the Western Conference Finals. Today we saw the Warriors win Game 3. They take a 2-1 lead after splitting in Houston. Steph Curry, was a big factor because he was criticizing game one and game two, only 2 for 16 from three.
Yes.
Maybe the knee is bothering him. From what you saw today, what do you like about what Steph was able to do? And the signal that he sends to the rest of the league, nah, I'm fine.
Yeah, well, you know, everybody almost kind of put Steph Curry in the back of their minds after the first not only two games, but 10 quarters of this series. He only made about like 2 threes, I think, in the first 10 quarters of the series. And he lit up the Rockets in the third quarter today. And he reminds everyone that, hey, I'm still here. I'm still big time. And I can still, you know, carry the fortunes of an entire game on my shoulders. Just like that, he made an 11-point lead blow up into something insurmountable for Golden State already.
All right. Although they still, you look at the Rockets, and they still did what they tried to do to him in game one, game two. They kept attacking him defensively, making him run around all these screens. When Chris Paul would penetrate, he'd really bang into him to really challenge his physical, you know, defense or whatnot. Is it just an aberration of how good Steph Curry just can be? And when it happens, you can't stop a guy like that? Or were the things, some of the things that the Rockets did in, well, in their win before that they weren't able to do today?
Well, the thing with Curry is what makes him, like what you said, TJ, unique compared to other shooters or other players is, and this is something I think Draymond said post game kanina, when he makes a three, it's like a slam dunk. It's not just 3 points.
And at home.
Yeah.
When he makes a three at home.
Yes, it energizes the team and the crowd. And they feed off of that really, really well. And combine that with the fact that Houston wasn't really, you know, making a lot of plays on the offensive end from their side. It just compounded things. And it, you know, when all those things come together, Steph Curry's production just snowballs into something. And when it gets really, really big, hindi mo na talaga matatalo ang Golden State.
All right. What does Houston need to do to make the adjustments? You hinted on this kanina in the Arizona show that their mistakes were correctable.
Yes, correctable.
Ano yung kailangan nila correct para sa game number four na kaya naman nilang gawin? It's not like they're outmatched or really, you know, are they like they're mismatched against a really team that is superior to them?
Well, as strange as this might sound, but in this particular series, for Houston to be able to get going offensively, their defense has to be tight.
Okay.
It has to be stout. And Mike D'Antoni talked about it post-game earlier this morning, that they weren't switching properly. They weren't following the game plan defensively. They weren't aggressive defensively. He felt that they could be a lot more physical, specifically, on the defensive end. And if they're going to be able to do that in Game 4, just like what they did in Game 2, then it's going to be a much closer game and a game that they can potentially win and square the series 2-2.
But here's the thing. You're talking about the Warriors who are running on a 17-game home playoff game winning streak. That's insane.
That's going to be tough.
Apparently, they beat the Bulls' old record of straight home
playoff games.
Although I don't know if it's a good omen that the last time they beat the Bulls' record didn't do so good for them, right? But looking at that, would you say clearly that the Warriors have the momentum and they have the edge in Game 4?
For sure. I mean, they're still the defending champions. Yep. They have four All-Stars team. Yeah, who've won the title, and they're the team to beat. But the thing is, what I like about Houston is they have, again, and I can't stress this enough, they have the MVP. And in my book, James Harden's the MVP.
Okay.
And anytime you have that person in your team, you can't be discounted. And you have a guy playing with a big chip on his shoulder in Chris Paul. You have a guy who has yet to break out. And I'm sure he's due in Clint Capella. And if you're Golden State, you got to expect that a counterpunch, that's going to be a hell of a strong counterpunch, is coming from Houston. You got to expect that in Game 4. And Houston, as good as Golden State is at home, Houston is no pansy on the road as well. They're a pretty solid road team.
So it should be all the more fun to watch out for when these two teams slug it out again on Wednesday morning. And maraming salamat. See you again too. Thank you.
Hey everybody, this is Anton Rojas. Subscribe to the ABS-CBN Sports and Action YouTube channel by simply clicking on the bell button for more updates.